Hello, this is the RPG Chick, and what the hell are we doing here with a bunch of dice? Well, the last episode was, well, the comments, whether to go into town with the incredibly old and disheveled people, or to pass, was a complete tie. Three said go in, and three said pass. So, based on your responses, I'm actually torn between trying to help these people and we'll see if I can help these people and avoid danger. I mean, we are an adventurer, but we don't have a lot of money and stuff, and I don't know. We've encountered some hard times so far in our adventure, so I kind of want to steer clear of danger for the time being as well. But so I'm going to roll a d4. 1 and 2, we go in. 3 and 4, we pass. Go. We're going in. Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. The let's play in which you help shape the outcome and journey of the game. So yeah, I already did my dice rolling thing. And we got a 1, which I determined. 1 and 2 was going in. So we're going to go and visit these people. Whatever's happening in this village is desperate. There's no laughter, no joy. No trade or commerce. The women do not walk about and the men do not watch them. It's like a prison camp. One's limping. A bunch are limping. Shuffling. Some use sticks. One is even crawling. So they're either naturally or magically made to be extremely old. In any case, we happen to be stumbling into Florida. I think that they're all pretty, cursed or something. But here we go. These are people in need of a savior. That's my reason for going in. You may not be that woman, but you can try. You approach, arms open, to show that you are not a threat. But the message is not understood. The villagers see you and panic. They begin to scurry inside their huts as if you were an army and not a lone traveler. Their bodies are thin and malnourished, and as they disappear through their windows, through their doors, sorry, you notice some are missing limbs. Walk straight through the village, and then out the village? Let's stop at a door and knock. You knock on one of the nearest huts. There is no reply. No reply at all. Well, we can either enter it, or I'm assuming here we're knocking on another door? It's not clear. You approach the next hut. From inside you hear the murmur of voices. So you enter. Great. The hovel is tiny and poor, with no furnishing of any kind. A small fire burns in the middle of the floor, and by the far wall a family of three cowers from you. The woman lifts a shaking hand as if to hold you back. I like how we just walk into people's homes because, voices! Let's barge in. Didn't even bother knocking at this one. Hold out a hand of friendship. You put out your hand to greet the man. He shuffles over nervously and grasps it with feeble strength. Are you magical, stranger? Are you not afraid of us?
Afraid? Why?
Why? He replies. Don't you know? We have the plague in this village. You spring back from him, but it is too late. You can feel the infection on the palm of your hand like a curse. Oh, crap. Another curse? Or like a curse? Why didn't you warn me?
The man looks at you with wide, sorrowful eyes.
I dared to hope, he whispers. You take another step back in fear and regret. You have but a few days.
Use magic. Oh, not on myself, but them. There is no question. You must do what you can for these people. Alright.
I have written down all the spells. I don't think we have anything for that. We don't have anything for lift curse.
Uh, I have How, which gives me psychic info on my safest escape. But that's kind of like a... like. That's for myself. And that's like if we're trapped, I think. I mean, this isn't a traditional trap. Protection from magic. Don't we want to cast that before magic is put on us? Oh, this is... oh, it's not necessarily a magical plague. I'm gonna try that, because we can't rely on our deity yet, I don't think. It hasn't been that long. How? I want to help myself first. I would help them, but I want to help myself first. So if this can help us... well, we don't have the option. I don't... see, there's the O. Yeah, I don't... I have to find out why that is exactly. I guess it's just the scripting of the game. We don't have everything available at one time. What am I kind of cast a spell? I can't help them. We have a cure illness or something? I don't think we do. Wait. We have a cure light wounds, but requires a medicinal potion. And we don't have that. I could try protection from magic. If it's an ongoing magical effect, should stop it, right? Maybe? Well, that's more like dispel magic. I'll see if we have an M. I don't know what else to do. Unless do something else will help. We have plenty of N's. And F's and R's, but no... alright, we're gonna do something else. Fear overtakes you and you race out of the door and do not stop running until you are clear of the accursed village. Great, guys. Thanks, die roll. We can do it. A prayer to your spirit will cure the plague, but after a prayer your spirit will not hear you again for some time. It hasn't been that long since we cleared the other thing, the curse. I guess that worked. Your spirit has heard you. You will receive no further help for some time. You are on your own. So I guess we don't have the plague. I wish we had like a status option. We see like effects put on us and stuff. Alright, guys. We're leaving the village. I don't know what I could possibly do to help them, except to cure light wounds, but I don't have a medicinal potion. Which kind of is weird. It is kind of weird, because if you have a medicinal potion, you don't have to cast a spell, right? The path beyond the village heads downhill once more between thick trees, before turning into a narrow goat track that crosses a rough peak. From the summit, you get a wide view. Look around. Ahead, down a steep slope, the next village is sprawled out before you, and even from here you can catch the sound of merry voices and shouting from the streets. It must be a carnival. Looking right, you hear a roaring noise, and you can just make out a beautiful, majestic waterfall plunging from a cliff into a great rock bowl. You watch for a few minutes, marveling at how clear the water seems. Then it is time to move on. You follow the track down a steep decline. head for the town. Well, it's the only thing we can do is head for the town. Crossing the bridge of Vancus. Some way down the hill you stop for a rest, and sit on a boulder to survey what lies ahead. The path leads downwards, and at its foot, cradled between three peaks, is a village, and quite a large one at that. Behind you, the sun is falling rapidly into the hills. It will be night soon. And there are geese? Ducks? I'm approaching the village. The village looks like a good place to stop. You hop down from the boulder and make your way forward when an overhanging branch touches your face and you hear a lively chirping. Turn around. You quickly turn around. Hovering by your shoulder is a small creature the size of a bird. It is childlike but very thin, with green skin, and it flits around you on transparent wings. It seems friendly enough. It even lands on your shoulder, its tiny clawed toes pinching slightly. Childlike but very thin. Talk to it. Greetings, little creature. And hello to you, the creature replies, chirping. My name is Jann. And there's Jann. What are you? The creature does a backflip and gives a low bow. I'm a Minimite. Pleased to meet you. It reaches out a tiny hand and shakes your earlobe. I'm not going anywhere till you're gone. What can you tell me about the village? You point down the valley. Is it safe? That's Shamutanti, and it's very safe. It's the largest village in the whole of the Shamutanti Hills. Every traveler who comes this way spends at least one night here. Or there. So it's a little bit expensive, especially for Minimites, but pleasant enough. The creature starts hopping up and down. Come on, it grumbles impatiently. Let's get going, can't we? What do you want with me? See that village? The creature replies. Last time I tried to go through, they said I wasn't welcome. So I wouldn't mind some protection. Oh, why is it not welcome? Because you're a Minimite, or because you have a history with these people? Yeah, neutral option. I'm not sure if I should protect it. I don't know this thing, what it wants, and what it's been up to. Let's get going then. The creature shakes you by the ear in excitement, and you set off along the path once more. You descend into the bowl of the valley. The hills on either side are toweringly tall and throw the village into deep shadow. It would seem a very gloomy, threatening place, but from the streets comes the distant sound of laughter and merriment. I gotta check out this town. At least they're not all shriveled and messed up. You continue along the path. The sounds of festivities grow louder. It's almost spooky here in the shade of the valley, and after so long on the dire road, the people in this village seem to be enjoying themselves. See? The Minimite on your shoulder remarks. I told you it was a happy place. Jann, what's going on? Are they bewitched? Jann shakes his head. No. If there were magic, believe me, I'd know. This is the Festival of the Young. What's that? Well, take a look. Jann waves a little hand around the village. The idea is that once a year, the children are allowed the freedom of the village. It's a time of great fun and lots of pranks. It becomes quickly obvious what he means. You pass the first few buildings, where you find a number of children sitting in the street and drinking ale from deep mugs. Further on, a young boy is holding an old woman over his knee and he's spanking her. On the other side of the tavern, a group of boys is fighting outside a hut with a sign that reads, Glandragor's Tavern. It is all but complete mayhem. Great, so we had a village of old people. Now we have a village of very, very young people. Shall I rescue the old woman from the spanking? It's so amusing. I kind of want him to continue, but then if we just leave, nothing's going to happen, right? We're just going to go to a different scene. So I guess we'll rescue her. You stride over to the boy, intending to rescue the woman. Well, I have no choice but to strike the child? That's not good. But at the sight of your manner and sword, the boy puts her down and gets to his feet. And what are you about? He demands. I am the leader of this village for today, and I say, get to bed. I don't want to strike the child. I really don't want to strike the child. There's nothing else to do. You reach out and smack the impertinent boy across the cheek with the back of your hand. The blow is not quite hard, but he still falls backwards into the mud. He is quite clearly enraged and lets up a hollering cry. Suddenly, there are 100 children round you, and not all beggars, but well-fed, and armed with sticks and pitchforks. Jann is making a hissing noise in your ear. Better run for it. Yeah, I'm not going to fight them. This is 100 of them? Yeah, I'm not going to fight them. But even if there were a smaller amount of children, I still wouldn't fight them because I'd be harming children, right? So let's run. Swallowing your pride, you turn and race out of the village. The children follow, standing by the gates and waving their impromptu weapons. Well, Jann sniffs, you're quite the warrior, aren't you? You told me to run for it. Well, we might not be completely done with this place yet. Let's camp outside and see what happens. It's the only place we can go. You make your way out of the village and into a stand of tall, dry trees under the overhang of one of the cool mountainsides. Between curling roots, you find a small place to settle down to rest. Jann perches a little way above a knot and is quickly asleep. You are tired enough to follow suit, but you are hungry from not having eaten. Let's eat something. Run ration left, guys. I don't suppose these little kids are gonna sell us rations. You pull out a quantity of your cheese and bread and eat quickly. The night's darkness The night's darkness draws in around you. In a distance, you hear screams and whoops from the village that only slowly fade. You feel lonely, distanced from such revelry. You rest your head onto your backpack and close your eyes. Perhaps a few hours pass when you wake suddenly, aware of a shadow moving between the tree trunks. It turns as it sniffs the air. A wolfhound! And also a bat? And whatever this thing is. It's sniffing at the air. Hiding won't work if it catches our scent. We are full stamina. Let's cast something. Now, you know, I have no lights on in this room. Hold on a second, guys. My little list isn't going to help if I can't see it. It seems nice to play it, you know. I can just actually set up candles and stuff. Right? That'd be cool. Alright, so what do we want to do? Some kind of offensive or defensive spell? If there was more than one of them, I mean, from the picture there's more than one of them, I don't know, but it only says there's one. That might just be, you know, a placement for several beasts. So otherwise I would charm animal. If I wanted to, I could summon a giant. Because I have a... Well, what's available? I'm thinking web, but I can't cast that. We can only cast something right now starting with B, J, or L. B, J. So I got big... We got law, which is charm animal. I mean, assuming that we have the next letter. BJ. Interesting system they have set up here. That's it. I can go into giant form. I could charm. Let's charm the animal. Maybe just make it go away or something. You could charm animal and, you know, unintelligent creatures. But what is it? It's a wolfhound. Okay, so it's not like a werewolf. Otherwise, then it might be intelligent, depending. So I am going to see if we can charm it. L. A. W. Control non-intelligent creatures requires 3 stamina. Bloop. You cast a spell, but strangely nothing happens. Great. The wolfhound wheels around. You must defend yourself against him. You draw your sword, the long metal flashing in the moonlight. The beast roars and howls. Only option is defend. Damn. I would like to win a battle, you know? The wolfhound creeps towards you, jaws dripping and fur shining wet. You raise your sword to defend yourself, fearing the monster will spring. It bounds forward. You are shaken but unharmed. What are you talking about? I lost stamina. It howls and whimpers. Why is it whimpering? We can only defend. You stay low and ready. Wait, am I supposed to? Wait. You stay low and ready. The wolfhound circles around you, snapping at the air. Oh, wait. I'm sorry, guys. I forgot. Sideswipe? Oh, I'm not doing too good here. You flick out your blade at the wolf, but the wolfhound is barreling forward with all hell's fury at its back. You are both knocked backwards into a tree. You bring your hand up to staunch your wound. The smell of blood is in the wolfhound's nostrils. It licks its lips with glee. It scrapes at the ground as if digging its own grave. Jab. Alright. You try a swipe. The wolfhound drops back. Thrust. Nice. You put all your strength into a swing of your sword, hoping to finish the creature in a stroke, but the wolfhound turns tail. Turns tail? That would mean it ran away. Not wanting to leave yourself open, you try a gentle stinging strike. The wolfhound runs quickly into the trees, but it has not gone for good. And the moment later, creeps back into view. It is tensing, preparing to pounce. Alright, defend. Oh, crap. The slavering beast goes for your throat. You react on instinct, dodging around a tree for cover, but you cannot hide forever. Cut. You bring your grip about for a wild blow, but the wolfhound races away. As the wolfhound grows weaker, its snarl gets madder. It moans and howls. Cut! You can actually win this, guys. You twist your blade around for a wild attack. The wolfhound drops low and your blade misses. The wolfhound is crawling now, its fur thick with dried blood. Oh. Dropping low, you try to frighten the creature off, but the wolfhound is too fast for you. It sinks teeth into your side. It turns about on the spot. Let's just do a jab. What? You test a weary jab. The wolfhound springs, knocking you back with its weight. Its eyes are black and dark. Oh, man. What? We got 1 point left to destroy this thing? You test a wary jab, but the wolfhound is a whirl of claws and swiping paws and knocks your blow aside easily as it comes for your blood. It licks your blood off the ground and grins. You howl with pain. The wolfhound, across the clearing from you now, howls too. It slinks away into the trees, only to emerge from another side of the clearing. Jab? What? You test a wary jab. The wolfhound swipes you with a paw, drawing blood. It makes a deep growling noise. You feel yourself on the edge of death. Defend? Ugh. Are you serious? The wolfhound snaps at you. You fling your sword up and knock the beast back. The wolfhound's jaws close around your throat and tear it free. I'm trying again. This is bull crap. Do jabs not work? Down to 5. You try a lunge, the wolfhound drops back. Thrust! Nice. The wolfhound rears back and swipes you like a bear. You pull all your strength into a sweep of your blade, hoping to finish the creature in a stroke. The blow connects. As the wolfhound grows weaker, its snarl gets madder. Sideswipe. Nice. That's all we had to do. Not wanting to leave yourself open, you try a gentle stinging strike. As the wolfhound weakly opens its jaws to bite, you plunge your blade between its teeth and all the way down to its heart. The wolfhound... wow. The wolfhound howls, a gurgling, blood-soaked sound, and then it dies. Yay! 2 stamina lost, competent combat. Even then we can try again. But no, I'm satisfied. The beast defeated you pause to regain your breath and wipe your sword. Go to sleep. Then, once satisfied, you lay down again and try to sleep. Jann flutters down and resettles on your shoulder. Your dreams are filled with walking. We've been doing a lot of that, with peaks and valleys and endless paths. A curious light plays across them, building walls to heights before ruining them as it moves away. The rest of the night passes silently. Alright, so we can't try again for this village. Now that the Night of the Children are over, whatever the hell, Festival of the Children. Let us continue beyond. I heard a growling or something. You rise early from your spot beneath the tree. As you gather your things, Jann leaps up and onto your shoulder. Ready to go? He chirps. Didn't he just want to go into Baratanti? What is he staying with us for? You rejoin the path on the far side of Baratanti. The sun sits on the horizon like a gleaming jewel. If all goes well, you will reach Torapani today, the last village in the Shamutanti Hills. After a short climb, the path breaks, heading uphill to the left and downhill to the right. Let's ask Jan's advice, why not? Which way, Jann? To the right is a forest. To the left going is easier. The path heads through a field of black flowers to Torapani. Okay. What else do you know? You demand suspiciously. Nothing, protests the creature. And that's a fine way to talk to your guide. I'm not charging you for my advice, you know. You'll get no more from the creature. With Torapani so close, it hardly matters which way you go, surely. If we go here... I hear wild dogs. We might get to check out this hut and the crystal waterfall here. Now where is this place? This is actually... We still end up going here anyway. I just want to see things, right? As opposed to our companion who's not really so much exploring as a quest to achieve. So what does he say? The left of going is easier. Well, we might get attacked by things, but I do want to check out that... I want to see if we can see what this is. Looks like a solitary building or two. I mean, this might be like an outhouse or something, or a storage shed. Let's go right. We go right, you decide. Then be on your guard, Jann warns you. Oh boy. You climb a rise. The way is not too steep, and as noon approaches, you have crested the ridge and are descending yet again. You are now at the highest point of the hills, where the trees are thin. The view west goes on forever, and sometimes you catch glimpses of Kare on the northern horizon. I don't want to stop and eat. We ate right before you went to bed. Which technically, in real life, you would eat again, but seems to be a ration lasts a day, I think. And we only have one of them. And I don't know when we can get more of them. So let's keep going. You decide not to stop to eat, but push on. Jann is in a talkative mood and fills the air around you with his chatter about what he can see and how things smell and what he plans to do once he makes his fortune in Kari. You pass from the open hillside into a patch of deep forest. Quite suddenly, Jann falls quiet and hisses in your ear. Stop! Stop now!
Why?
Because, insists the creature in a tiny voice, because something is following us. You come to a dead stop. Jann is right. Something is moving through the trees behind you. A moment later, a point of steel has emerged from the darkness between two trees and touches your neck.
You've seen me, whispers a voice. I know it.
Answer? I see nothing, you call back. You are quite safe.
It is not I who is not safe, returns the voice.
Ask who is there. There is no reply, but the tall, dark figure of an assassin emerges from the trees. He is dressed head to toe in black, and you had not seen him a moment before, even though he had been standing a mere arm's length away. He wields a sharp scimitar in expert hands.
Cast a spell.
Okay, we've got K, Z, W, and F. K, Z, W, and F. Well, we got... Metal shield, which takes up a gold piece. Not much. We have a lightning bolt. Invisible wall. Feather fall. Oh, that's not gonna work. Darkness. Any more? Yeah, I think that's it. What starts with K? Oh wait, we have more on the other side. I couldn't fit them all. Crap. Enhanced illusion, we need a bracelet of bone for that. Teleport, we need a ring of green metal. All this stuff requires stuff. Well, the mystery spell. I don't want to use that. Duplicate enemy requires a gold back mirror. Invisible wall. Let's do that. Hopefully he'll be on the other side of the invisible wall. What is it again? W-A-L for wall. Oh, I can't. It's only W-O. Damn it. Cast a lightning bolt? Do we have time to do that before he kills us? Or force field? Nope. You can't do faff. What? He's gonna kill us. We only have 10 stamina. You cast a spell, but nothing results. Great. Why does nothing result? I should probably tell you, Jann whispers. Minimites are protected by an aura. It is a curse. Sometimes. Like now. Because you can't cast magic while I'm nearby, and I'm not leaving while that assassin is there. Oh, thanks for telling me. That's why the charm animal spell didn't work either against the wolfhound.
You bring your sword up to bear. The assassin nods at you, raises his curved sword in salute, and readies his stance. You begin with a quick stab, expecting the assassin to be cautious at first. He covers himself. He is left breathless, but otherwise unharmed. My duty is to sever your head from your neck, he tells you, in a voice as cold as polished marble. You will not hold me from it. Sideswipe? In the next moment, he is on you in a flash. With your blade close, you are ready to parry. His own blow is measured, but enough to knock you reeling. Sinla forgive you, he declares as he swings. The impact of his swing catches you in the side. As he pulls the blade clear, he lifts you from the floor and kicks you in the stomach. The assassin spins his sword about to shift the sword across his body. He's defending. So I can either defend as well. You drop yourself into a crouch. His light blow sails over your head, moving with the deadly speed of an attacking serpent. You are mostly unharmed. Cut. Nice. We just need to do that 6 more times. Time to attack. You swing your sword fast in towards his chest, but the impact clangs against his closed sword. He grins. He is bruised, but not seriously hurt. Closing his eyes, the assassin murmurs a quick prayer as he sets his stance. I'm still being cautious here. Yeah, ouch. Damn it. Then he is diving forward for your throat. You parry as best you can. His own swing is devastatingly placed. The force of his blow bruises you in the side. You stagger quickly away, leaving a trail of blood across the dirt. I'd be a little bold here. Acting quickly, you slash violently across his chest, but the blow jumps back off the hilt of his blade. He grimaces with effort. He is battered, but ready to come back stronger. The assassin swivels his grip. The weapon sings as it moves. Jab. We're not going to make this. The assassin laughs. Keeping your sword low, you are able to counter as he catches you with a passing slice across your cheek. You are weakening. This fight is becoming serious. He flicks the blade through the air, crouching as he moves. It was already serious. Leaping into action, you twist and lower your sword quickly, but the blow you land is only minor, because the assassin has adjusted his stance swiftly. Blood drips from the assassin's tunic. He curses under his breath. You will die out here, he declares, his tone like ice. Cut. Damn it. Shameful! The trees watch as the battle unfolds. Relentlessly you cut and thrust, keeping him pinned. You cleave your blade mercilessly across his back. He is off balance and moving slowly, and the blade goes deep. He turns and tumbles, releasing his sword as he topples. I am not so proud as to not admit when I am beaten, he groans. You may finish me if you so choose, but if you do, do me an honor and use my own blade. So we both just killed each other right now. We're trying again. Now I'm gonna it doesn't look like he was prepared for my swipe the first time. So I'm going to completely charge. Which should have taken off a lot more than one. I got 9 against him. Same thing. I'm just gonna jab at this point. See, he got 8 and I got 2 off of me. Thank you.
The trees watch as the battle unfolds. Relentlessly you cut and thrust, keeping him pinned. You twist and lower your sword quickly, but the blow you land is only minor because the assassin has adjusted his stance swiftly. Blood drips from the assassin's tunic. He curses under his breath. "I can guarantee you a simple death," he says. His eyes are merciless. All we can do is defend, jab, and sideswipe. And that's ouchy. Did it! The assassin is not dead, but lies on the floor, gasping. Huh. Finish him and search his body. With a single blow, you finish the assassin. He dies with his lips pursed in silent prayer, not cursing you, but commanding his own soul to a better place. Good, we've had enough with curses and plagues and stuff. You rifle his body for a measly 3 gold pieces. Okay. That's welcome. We only had 13. Then continue on the path out of the woods and onto a dusty hillside. Jann, for a brief while, says nothing. Perhaps he is shocked, but the blissful silence doesn't last for long. We can only leave the trees. Again, another long episode, guys, but I'm waiting for a good, you know, choice. How much longer do you think we'll be traveling today? The Minimite on your shoulder asks. I'm hungry and tired. We've gone such a long way. You can stop here. The Minimite complains. You'd like that. I'm sure you would. You continue along the path and around the side of a hill. A wooden hut is set into the slope, with an old woman sitting on the front step. A river seems to emerge from beneath her. As you get closer, you realize that the water flows underneath her house, and the house itself is set on splayed struts like an insect, straddling the water course. A few paces from the front of the house, the water plunges over the edge of a sheer cliff and disappears. I would make this the choice for you guys to vote on, but I feel stupid because I just came here to check out this house, right? So let's greet the woman. Greetings, you call. The woman looks up at you and smiles. Come over here, won't you? She calls. I can barely see you. Okay, continuing with wanting to check out the house. You approach the old woman. She smiles a toothless smile and gets up from the step. Come in, please, she beckons. I get so lonely living out here on my own, away from the villages. Alright, guys, I'm gonna leave this. She's very welcoming, isn't she? I mean, she doesn't even know who we are, I'm assuming. So, yeah, I'm gonna make this the next choice. We have 4 stamina. Should we go inside? Maybe she'll give us some rations. Maybe we could rest. Or maybe this is some kind of a trap. And we are doomed to fall with our lifeless corpse falling down the waterfall into the waters below. Either one is a possibility. So thanks for watching, guys. Yeah, let me know. Are we going in? Or are we just going to stay away from this lady? We might still be able to interact with her if we stay outside also. There's that possibility. But she might, you know, she might not be happy if we don't come inside. That kind of thing. I have no idea. So, yeah, let me know what you guys think. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks for comments. And as many people as possible, you know, if you could let me know, because the more votes we have, the less, you know, chance of a tie situation. I can always roll dice, you know, but just food for thought. Thanks again, guys. See you next time, next week, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.